talking about here tonight is a huge spiritual challenge to even face. It requires a lot of spiritual fortitude. And all of you sitting here who are willing to learn more about this are really to be congratulated. You're among the bravest people and in the area, for sure. And we really, really, really appreciate all of your efforts. And I hope you can get galvanized to do even more after tonight and hearing all the speakers that are here tonight. We live along the West Marin coast, and in this beautiful, beautiful state, along the coast, will be accumulating more radiation from Fukushima. And when I faced that reality, it was like facing an individual death. At first I didn't want to really believe it. I was in denial. Then I was so furious. And then I thought, well, you know, maybe it isn't so bad, bargaining. And then I finally accepted, yes, we're going to have to deal with this. And all the rest of the generations of the human species is going to have to deal with what is going on now at Fukushima. And unfortunately, Fukushima isn't the only site that this could happen at. And you'll understand if you don't already. How many people here have been following this very closely? Okay, thank you. When the explosions at Fukushima occurred in March of 2011, clouds of cesium-134 and 137 were shot up into the air and then into the jet stream, and was carried across the jet stream all over the planet. There were people who were saying, oh, let's go to the southern hemisphere, but you know what? The southern hemisphere showed elevated spike in radiation not too many months afterwards. So first it went across the Pacific and then up Alaska, and it's covering the planet there, as you can see. And this was from those explosions that created this cloud of radioactive debris. Then, as we now know, that TEPCO, the company that operates the Fukushima Daiichi plants, has been dumping contaminated water into the ocean constantly, every day, since the catastrophe first occurred. They can't really help it. I mean, they could if they had done early on what some engineers have suggested, like Arne Gunderson. But they have groundwater flowing through. The groundwater picks up the contamination from the melted through reactors, as well as the water that's created by trying to keep those reactors cool and trying to keep the spent fuel pools cooled, all of which would create even worse problems if they weren't constantly inundated with water. This shows how the ocean currents move through the entire planet, the global conveyor belt. You've heard about the Gulf Stream in the Atlantic. Well, there's one similar in the Pacific. That's the Kuroshio Current. And what it does is it starts forming right, going very deep right in front of Fukushima. And then it moves across and up, see, over to the North Pacific, goes up to Alaska, along Alaska, and then down the entire west coast of North America, and then it loops back again. And then the convergence zone there, where the North Pacific gyre is, where all the plastic congregates, you know, that and has been moved, it's sort of like the belly button of the Pacific. And that's where the concentrations are the highest of the radiation right now. The National Oceanic and Atmospheric Association, NOAA, along with the Geomar Research Center for Marine Geosciences, have put together a simulation based on a tracer cloud that they've injected dyes into the ocean. And what that showed was this kind of dispersal. And they can see the days above there on the upper left and how quickly it's moving through the ocean, because there's surface currents as well as the looping currents. And what that has shown in their simulation, and by the way, their simulation was based on only one release of about a couple of weeks. They didn't say how exact they were, but as we now know, this is a continuing release. So that has to be added into their understanding when they did this simulation. But it's still useful to see how it moves and disperses throughout the Pacific. What they're saying is that the concentration, because the current is very strong as it leaves Fukushima, and it starts moving very quickly and deeply, then when it gets along the north or the west coast of North America, it tends to slow down. And so they are saying that there may be an accumulation along the west coast of these of the radiation that may make our west coast actually more radioactive than off the shores of Japan. So what we can see is that they're saying that this current will reach the northwest coast around 2014. It reaches Alaska before that, and then moves down Canada and down to where we are. The Japanese have done measurements of plankton throughout the Pacific, and 10 different places throughout the Pacific. And in every place they tested, there was elevated levels of cesium-134 and 137. The greatest concentrations were in this Pacific gyre area in the center that actually is northeast of Hawaii, I believe. So let's talk about measuring. Shortly after the catastrophe, many of the government radiation monitors that were supposed to protect us from inadvertent exposures were turned off. They in their wisdom, decided that we didn't need to know any more about what was happening. But what happened was people in some universities measured the kelp off the shore of Long Beach and found that the levels of iodine-131 were elevated immediately after the catastrophe. And bluefin tuna, which are migratory fish that actually spawn next to offshore in the Fukushima area, did have cesium. And they were surprised about that, because cesium can be excreted from the body, but the fish actually still had measurable levels of cesium in their flesh by the time they got to the West Coast, where they were caught and checked. And so the second year after Fukushima, bluefin tuna were again tested, and 15 out of 15 also tested high in elevated levels of cesium. But the scientists who measured that said, oh, not to worry. Those levels are below our level of concern here in the United States. However, the United States permissible levels of radiation, the guidelines are 1,200 becquerels per kilogram, which is among the highest in the world. And so it's not health related. They just decided 1,200 becquerels per, and a becquerel is a decay per second, a disintegration of a radioactive particle per second. So it's okay to eat things that have 1,200 becquerels per kilogram in your body. That's what they're saying. When you talk about radioactive contamination, the most severe damage occurs from the radioactive particles getting inhaled or ingested through food and water, and then they lodge in your body. The body recognizes cesium the same as potassium. Just like you've heard about iodine, 131 radioactive iodine is absorbed by our thyroids, which use iodine and must have iodine. Well, the same thing happens with cesium. Cesium is recognized as potassium, so it's taken into the muscle tissue. It can get into your digestive tract, but that way you can flush it out if it's in your digestive tract through eating apple pectin, for instance. That's been proven by studies on children after Chernobyl. Strontium-90 is now, we're seeing, has been measured in what's been released as well in the water. And strontium-90 gets absorbed as calcium and goes into the bones and into the teeth. So it would get into fish bones as well and teeth. And then that's harder to, it doesn't get excreted. So these are the things that we're having to deal with now. And going back to the 1,200 becquerels per kilogram, Dr. Yuri Bandijevsky, who is a medical doctor, who's the head of the Medical Institute at Gomel Institute of Medicine in Belarus. After Chernobyl, he did testing of autopsies, of tissues from children's autopsies, and he found that cesium caused disease to begin at the level of 11 becquerels per kilogram, and that disease was permanent by the time it was 50 becquerels per kilogram. So if you constantly ingest food that is allowed to have 1,200 becquerels per kilogram, you can imagine how quickly that would get you into disease levels, and particularly children and pregnant women and infants. Also, the National Academy of Sciences, the Biological Effects of Ionizing Radiation, BIR-7 report from 2006, has shown, clearly states, that there is no safe level of radiation. And in fact, what they have shown is that children are, of course, more vulnerable, the elderly, the infirm, and women are more susceptible than men, and girl children are the most susceptible. This is our reproducing of our species that's at stake here. And I'm reading more and more, by the way, studies that are showing the same thing is true for non-ionizing radiation, which is the wireless, the cell phones, and that women are more sensitive, and girl children. So what we, one more fact about that, when you ingest that radioactive particle, then this is different, you know, from X-rays, by the way. That just goes through. Those are waves. Gamma radiation, just waves. But if you have a particle of radiation, which is a heavy metal, it can lodge inside you and stay there forever, irradiating the cells right next to it, which, you know, is the way the body is affected. And then they tend to go into the organs, the lungs, the heart, the pancreas, the liver, etc., to cause problems. So what to do? Our organization joined with others to form Fukushima Fallout Awareness Network, FAN, and we've got information over there. There are a lot more information than I'm going to be able to talk about now. Fukushima Fallout Awareness Network has submitted an official legal document to the FDA to demand that the permissible levels for radiation in food and supplements be lowered to 5 becquerels per kilogram, and that they do systematic testing of our food and supplements. And we need support in that. We can talk with more detail over there. Rachel is right there from Eon with an array of different herbs, of all things. Now, these won't cure your problem from radiation, but there are studies that have been done that show that, for instance, cancer patients undergoing radiation treatments, which uses gamma radiation, not the particles. But anyway, we're hoping that these same herbs that fortify and help the survival rates from that kind of radiation may help with fortifying the body and somewhat diminishing the bad effects of the particles that may get lodged in your body. People say eat seaweed. Seaweed, I mean, some of the foods that we know were really to be looked for, mushrooms, seaweed, that before Fukushima were really good for you because they hyperaccumulated minerals. Well, those things are hyperaccumulating the radiation. So if they're in exposed water, they're going to be more highly contaminated than other foods. So we have more information over there, a lot more to think about. But apple pectin can help flush through cesium, and there are other ways of dealing with this that we can talk about afterwards. Thank you.
We need to get subscribed and get this unity stronger and beat YouTube at their own game. Okay, that's what this is about. Like I say, go to the remix button, hit the remix button. That way you'll have this video and keep up with this. Otherwise, you know, YouTube's just going to control us, guys, and it's really bad.